This time on Holy Ghost Notes.
What have you been up to this year?
Became a drummer.
Yeah!
Oh my gosh, really?
What's going on? This is Matt and Tim, and you are listening to Holy Ghost Notes.
Yo.
What's going on, Tim?
Not too much, man. It's a late one. I am struggling. My eyes are closing.
I can see that.
Yeah.
Yeah, well, we'll keep this quick and get to the point. We have a very special guest on today, Alex Shelnutt from A Day to Remember. We had our share of technical difficulties, as we usually do with... it seems like, you know, if we are excited about an episode with a guest, which we usually are, we're like, okay, we have everything ready to go. You know, we've dotted our I's, crossed our T's. You know, I cleaned out the Zoom, you know, recording. I have Pro Tools ready to go. I you know, checked it twice or three times. Everything's good. And then we get on here and just right away something falls apart. And that's what happened. But we pushed through, persevered, and we have a good episode for you guys. Alex is a great dude. He's a good friend, and you'll get to know a little bit about him and how he got started with A Day to Remember, what he's been doing during COVID. We cover a lot of topics.
Yeah.
It's a good conversation.
Yeah, I wish that you guys could actually hear the conversation that happens before and after the episodes and kind of be a fly on the wall for, like, the texts that go back and forth, like, planning this thing and then afterwards. Because, like, you know, I listen back to these episodes and I hear it from a point of view with context. You know, I remember what happened and what was discussed beforehand, and I really know the person that we're talking to a little bit better than the little snapshot that you get on this interview. And I wish you guys could be a part of that, because, man, like, in this case, like, Alex is, like, one of the most genuine people I've ever met. Like, no ego there. In fact, a little bit of the reverse, I would say. He's just such a good dude. You know, really engaged in the conversation, and you'll probably notice, like, the biggest issue I think we had on this episode was the lag on Zoom. So Matt and I were, like, in sync. We were in time with each other, but Alex was hotspotting from his phone, and so there was major gaps between, like, our questions and his answers. And it almost sounds at times like we're, like, interrupting or talking over each other because there's such a lag. But hopefully you guys get the gist of it and the integrity of this interview comes through, because it really was a great conversation. This is the first one, actually, that we had to take an entire chunk of the interview out. I think the first issue that we ran into was you lost... like, your Pro Tools stopped running, right?
Yep. And, I had some difficulty. And then Alex had some Wi-Fi stuff. So you did a lot of work to make it sound the way you, as a listener, are about to hear this.
Yeah.
It's going to sound much improved as compared to what the actual recording was like. To your point, there's a lot of work. It's a lot of work to pull these together, but the end result's always worth it. And we're just glad we can get a little snapshot of these artists' stories or lives or perspectives out to you guys to check out. It's worth it to us. It's worth it to us to shed some light on who these people are, who these drummers are, who these personalities are, effectively, you know, celebrities are in a lot of cases. The one thing I was thinking about as we were about to set up for this is, I wish that, so there are two different types of people in the music industry. One, the type of person that says, I'm very famous and I'm very popular and I'm very talented and I know it. And then there's another type of person who says, I'm pretty famous. They're pretty famous. They're pretty popular. They're very talented, and they don't project that image.
Yeah.
In fact, a lot of times they don't believe it for themselves.
Yeah.
And that would be Alex. And I wish that I could convince someone like Alex or someone like Adam Gray from Texas in July. There's a few other drummers that I can think of right off the top of my head who I see, when I look at them, I see a certain set of you know, characteristics.
Yeah.
You know, and when they talk to me or when we're having a conversation, I can tell that they do not see themselves that way.
Right.
They just don't.
Yeah.
You can tell it's just like oozing out of them. And as much as you try to reinforce the fact that no, like you are really good at this, or no, you've done so much to get here, or no, your band is incredible. Mm-hmm. You can't make someone else believe that.
Yeah.
And so it kind of begs the question, is it better to be someone who is fully confident in where you are at as a musician and in a band?
Mm-hmm.
Or is it better to err on the side of, you could consider it humility. In some cases, I think it could be what in the Christian sense would be false humility, mm-hmm. which is like, I know I'm all these things, but I don't know how to accept those things. Right. So I'm going to just play this idea that I'm not.
Mm-hmm.
It feels more comfortable to do that. And how do you walk that line? No matter what your opinion is on this, it would be impossible to argue. It's impossible to say that it's a difficult thing to be a popular musician in a popular band and have this set of skills and have everyone constantly telling you and reinforcing that.
Yeah.
Because at the end of the day, you got to go home and you got to do laundry and you got to brush your teeth and you got to have your own relationships with people who really know you,
mm-hmm.
who really understand what kind of person you are, your flaws,
mm-hmm. right,
your shortcomings, you know? And so it stands in stark contrast to what everybody else is telling you.
Yeah.
And so the thing about Alex that I really appreciate is that he is just a humble person who just loves to, he loves the things that he loves in life because they give him joy.
Mm-hmm.
Skateboarding, you know, video games, drumming, and he's pursued those things and he's dedicated time to those things
yeah.
for such a long time consistently that one of them broke through, which is drumming.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
He used to have a skate park in his backyard. I don't know if he still does, but he's pursued all of them,
yeah.
you know, and he's pretty good at all of them. Obviously a very good drummer.
Yeah.
And ADTR is just an incredible band, but it was just kind of an interesting perspective. I think it's worth talking about and thinking about in your own life as you're listening to this. What are you known for? How do people view you? And do you view yourself that way? If you do, is there an air about you that maybe you need to work on?
Mm.
I know I do
yeah.
at times with certain things with drumming and my band and this and that. And it's like, I shouldn't have carried myself that way just because, I don't know, people tell me this about myself.
Right.
It's like, well, at the end of the day, we all need to be looking at each other with this, you know, level vision. But at the same time, I think it's just as dangerous sometimes to err on the side of, I am nothing, as an easier argument or counter argument to, actually, you're pretty good at this.
Yeah. Yeah.
So how do you accept that sort of compliment? I think Alex does a good job of walking that line just because he is such a joyful person.
Yeah.
In regard to like his hobbies in life.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So I don't know if that resonates with you at all.
Oh,
I know
yeah.
we kind of talked about that a little bit.
I think you hit the nail on the head. And the other thing I was going to say about him is just, you know, to be able to play like he does, you obviously have to put the time and effort in. We've talked about this a number of times, and he's the type of drummer too, similar to a lot of the drummers that we tend to favor, where
yeah.
he's got his own sound. You can tell this is Alex Shelnutt playing. You know,
if
another drummer were to take his place sitting on the kit behind ADTR Remember, it would be different. It would sound different. And I feel like Alex has really helped develop the band's style. And I don't know if
he realizes
how much of a part of that he is. You know?
That's a better point than I just made. I think it's making the same point, but it's a different... It's the same argument made with a different point, and that he benefits
right.
the band in a way that
yeah.
I'm not so sure he realizes.
Absolutely, yeah. He's a key member, and I know I'm biased because I'm a drummer and I listen for these things, but like even like you watch, I haven't seen like everything that they put out, but I know I've seen like some of their videos that they put out like to plug new albums and stuff like that. And they're just a fun band. They
yeah.
really have a lot of personalities within the band. And I think Alex is one of the personalities that stand out specifically.
Yeah.
I think it was his episode it was not the Homesick album. It was the one after that, I think, that while they were in the studio, they put a bunch of like webisodes out back when webisodes were a thing. And there was one specific episode that I just remember because of him where he was like recording. He was like in the studio recording and he got it in one. This is all a joke, of course, but he got it all in one take and then came in and he was like listening to another song in his headphones while he played the take perfectly. And it was just like the personality's there, you know, the talent's obviously there. And it was just, it's fun to watch him. And typically, like, you know, when I'm, what I appreciate about drummers is more than just how articulate they are on the kit or how proficient they are, but also how fun they are to watch. You know, if they look like they're having a good time up there, I'm going to have a good time watching them, you know? Yeah, and Alex is one of those guys too. So anyway.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah. We could exhaust this this exact conversation, but I guess before we get into the interview, I just want to let you all know that we have a Patreon. It's patreon.com/holyghostnotes. And basically, we started it so that we wouldn't have to run ads and or make, you know, these episodes cost any money. We wanted to keep the integrity of the podcast as much as possible. And basically, we also wanted to give everybody listening the opportunity to get behind the podcast, support us if they want to, but also just, you know, get involved more. So we have an amazing community group called the Inner Circle. They're some of my best friends, and I'm not just saying that. I've gotten to know a lot of them very well, and they're just such good people, and they really epitomize what Holy Ghost Notes is all about at this point, and they've helped us grow and develop this podcast since January. So if any of you are interested in getting more involved in the podcast, you know, or just supporting us, if you like what you hear and you want to help us keep going, check out patreon.com/holyghostnotes. Your support gets you some cool stuff. In fact, we just landed on some new merch. So we're going to be releasing that soon for everybody. At certain tiers, you get some exclusive drum lessons. And then at the triplet tier, you actually get immediate access to mattgreinerlessons.com, which is Matt's subscription service. A lot of cool stuff there for you to take advantage of. And probably the coolest thing that we do is actually give a percentage of our earnings each month to a charity or a cause that we care about. So in addition to just helping the podcast, we're trying to make a difference in the world. So that's a little bit about the Patreon. I'm not going to talk about it more, but if you're interested, check it out, patreon.com/holyghostnotes.
Good stuff. Yeah. We got merch. I love it.
Got merch.
Yep. All right. So let's do this.
Yeah.
Alex Shelnutt from A Day to Remember. Enjoy.
Yeah.
What's going on? This is Matt and Tim from Holy Ghost Notes, and we have a very special guest on today, Alex Shelnutt from A Day to Remember. Alex, how you doing?
Good. How are you guys doing?
Doing well now that we have this going. It's always a chore to try to set one of these up.
Oh, yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
It's like I just tore my entire studio apart to take one picture, literally just one picture, for a drum sample pack that I'm making. And it's like, oh, shoot, we have an hour until this, you know, until we go live. Ah, no problem. Well, of course, an hour and a half later, I'm like, my mic won't work. It's like,
it's always
okay,
something.
Yeah. Figure it out. Yeah. Yeah, man. Thank you so much for coming on here.
Yeah, of course.
We were just talking about how I was on your podcast a while ago now.
Oh, yeah.
And you're now returning the favor. So I really appreciate that.
About a year later or something, finally.
Jeez, so much change in a year.
Oh, yeah.
Right? So okay, so first of all, your studio looks awesome.
Thank you.
I like Larry David in the background. tell us how your studio came to be, and did you Did you build this out this year during your downtime, or what have you been up to this year?
I used to have it in a different room. It was a little bit smaller, and it's kind of just been adding and adding different pieces of gear and reconnecting, deconnecting. Sometimes what you were just talking about, something will stop working once I get one other thing hooked up in there. But it's finally to the point where I pretty much have everything like ready to go. Like I got my electronic drum kit here. I got my Kemper for my guitars. Got a bunch of MIDI stuff, a bunch of random analog gear that I never use, but it's fun to mess with. I just like to write random stuff when I get a wild hair up my ass.
Do you play guitar?
Yeah.
I didn't know that.
Yeah, I'm not great. I'm good enough to write something, but I'm not great.
That's awesome. Yeah. I'm curious to know, what are some ways that you have continued to challenge yourself as a drummer?
As a drummer, truthfully, lately, I've been pretty lazy and uninspired, full truth be told. I've been trying to write some stuff. I've been trying to practice. Mentally just kind of not as much there as I'd like to be. But, you know, I still, I've been using my practice pad a lot. I've been going to the studio and playing drums and practicing some stuff. But I don't know. It's been a rough, you know, mental thing on me. And I feel like that makes it worse, like knowing I should be and could be doing more right now, but then not doing it. It's kind of like a never-ending cycle of just like being down on myself because of that and then not doing anything about it. But it's been...
Yeah, I understand that.
Yeah, it's tough.
For sure. I mean, you get into a routine with something and being... I mean, Tim, we've talked about this. Being in a routine actually forces your hand to... be more involved in it, even though you're busier. So this is a weird year because you have all the time in the world, but you probably have less motivation, it sounds like, to practice or to play than usual.
Yeah, I get like random spurts of motivation, but you know, it hasn't been sticking like it usually does.
You know? Sure.
I feel like it's knowing that we're not going on tour for a while. It's knowing, you know, I've been letting it take over me more than I should, I guess. That makes sense.
Yeah. Do you think...
I think a lot of people are in that place.
Do you think some of it has to do with the fact that you don't have like a scheduled band practice, you don't have a scheduled tour, you're just sort of in limbo and you have nothing to prepare for and push you?
I think that's a big part of it for sure. And yeah, I think that's like a huge part of it because even when we're home, not during COVID times, we still have like band practices, we're still writing stuff, we're still doing whatever, but you know, hasn't really been much of that lately.
For sure. I mean, it's tough. We've talked about going to the gym and how if you're going to go to the gym often, you have to set up a schedule. Otherwise, you're just not going to do it. And if you don't go to the gym for 4 or 5 months, it's really hard to get back into it and commit to it again.
Yeah, I just started like riding my bike a bunch recently. Just to do something active, you know, like to get, you know, it was before the wedding. I wanted to make sure I fit into my suit and all that. And so I've been doing that every day. But actually, fun fact, I woke up this morning and my bike got stolen.
Oh my gosh, so, really?
So
I'm so sorry to hear that.
Yeah, so it's all good. It's one of those things.
Man, so was it sitting on your front porch or...
No, it was in my carport, like, kind of hidden, so someone must have known it was there. It was, like, a long driveway that, like, I mean, I should have put it in the backyard, but I woke up, went to my car, noticed bike.
Oh, my gosh.
Dude.
Jeez. Is that something terrible that you can go to the police about and report it and say, hey, this is gone and I need help?
I can, but it's like my third bike that's gotten stolen since I've lived in Orlando. I've reported it like all the time, but nothing ever really happens.
Jeez, that's terrible. I just saw the producer that we work with, Carson Slovak, he posted online that his laptop that has a bunch of audio files on it and all of his kids' pictures from the time that they were born was stolen out of his car.
No.
Like the one day he leaves his laptop in his car and it's just gone. So, man, what a tough start to your day. I'm thankful that you were even able to, like, get past that mentally and come on a podcast and, like, you know, commit to something like this.
I feel like at this point of the year, I'm just like...
Yeah.
It's 2020. Bring it.
It's fine.
It's on par with 2020. Jeez, man. Yeah. So what do you think... Just thinking about this introspectively, what do you think? Let's just say hypothetically that you have a tour scheduled for next July. Do you think that that would change the way that you view practicing now, or would you wait until January, February, March, April of next year to like really hit it again? Like, what's your take on practicing?
No, I think it would help. If we had something at all, you know, but we have like one show at Download next year in like August.
Okay.
And that's already kind of like picked me back up a little bit, but like, you know, if we had some more stuff lined up, but
man,
I think that would help a lot.
So far away. That's a full blown 10 months away
really
from
is.
Now.
Yeah.
Our first tour back is November.
And it's like at the same time
of 2021, you know, it's even further away.
Oh, I figured. I was like, wait, of this year?
No.
I was like, man, I hope it works. I really do.
You guys are going out there soon, man. Europe doesn't seem to care. Like,
all right. Yeah.
Oh, man. Yeah, it's just crazy. So are you guys writing any music or anything? Like, are you kind of taking advantage of having this extra time just sitting here?
I mean, we have a record that's done, and we just are waiting to release it.
Mm. Gotcha. Okay.
I don't know when we are, but I want to put it out, but it's just a weird time.
Yeah. So the record's done.
Waiting on, like, some artwork stuff. And. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Man, we put out a record this year, and it was definitely a scary time to put something out when you just don't know how it's going to be received and if people are going to care.
Yeah.
I mean, this was back.
You can't go out
like,
and play the songs and stuff.
Like, you can't play them. You can't talk about the new record. Yeah. Yeah. Mm. So this just reminded me of when we could tour. And not all that long ago, I came to see you play in Reading, which is an hour away from my house. And I had texted you a couple days before. You remember that? And I'm like, hey, I have a blast bell. Would you ever find a spot to use this bell?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. I remember that.
And you're like, actually, yeah, bring it. So I thought maybe you would just like hit it a couple times, you know, backstage, take it home and throw it with your stack of cymbals. That's what I had in my head because I know how I work. And oftentimes that's probably what would happen. You would just sort of put it with the rest of your gear. So I get there and you came out to meet myself and a couple friends and you took us back, backstage. And then you disappeared. Like, where did Alex go? And someone's like, oh, he went to stage with your bell. I'm like, really? So then like maybe like half an hour later, you came back to the backstage area. And I was like, so did you go play the bell? Did you go check it out? You're like, oh, yeah. And you're like, I'm going to play it tonight. He's like, or you're like, I had a stand all ready to go for it. Like, we have it mic'd up. We're good.
Wow.
Okay.
Oh, yeah. I was stoked.
All right. So then...
I hit it way, way more times than I should. I just found places and songs.
So I would
just put it in fills and stuff.
Oh, yeah. Instead of a tom, just put a bell there, you know. I was standing in front of house, and it's like middle of the show. I think it was Jeremy was like, all right, so this next song... I've always wanted this to happen, and it's about to happen. Let's go. So you played the song, and it gets to this big breakdown moment where nothing's happening. You're just like, bing, breakdown. Song ends. Jeremy takes a mic. He's like, that was sick. That song has never sounded better. Our drummer, Alex, give it up for Alex. Woo, you're like, he always hits the ride bell, and you can hardly even hear it. Finally hit this new bell. Mac Reiner's here. Everyone give it up for Mac Reiner. And like six people cheered because no one knows who I am at a Data Remember show. But I was thrilled. I was like jumping up and down like, yeah. That was incredible.
Dude, well, he always would complain about that part because, like, you know, like, even if I hit the ride bell as good as I could, he would just give me this look because it wasn't this, like, actual bell. And he would just give me the stink eye, like, every time. He'd just be like, it's really funny.
Yeah, yeah. And you're like, what do you want me to do? I don't have one of those loud bells that no drummer should have, you know? Like,
then you came and saved the day, man. And now it's just always on my kit. Now it's just forever there.
The blast bell lives on your kit.
Yeah, shameless plug about the blast bowl. Yeah. For sale now.
Yeah, for sale now.
I fully endorse it.
Oh, thank you. That's very sweet of you. Man, that was fun.
It's not like too high pitch of a ding. It's like the perfect little, like, perfect ding.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah. It doesn't
perfect
ring
tone
for
of a ding.
3 years either, like a Zobel no. does.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
That was the one thing I hated about the Zill bell. Not that I ever really needed a straight up bell, but man, especially like recording with it, like just not even worth it.
You have to put it in like another
going
room.
And going and going. Yeah, seriously.
Recording with it, yeah.
You have to put like a mute on it, and even that wouldn't work.
Oh yeah, like
it's crazy.
Two moon gels on it.
It's insane.
Oh, that's funny. So, Alex, we've toured together quite a few times, like we talked about, and as I was thinking about this morning, we don't really talk drums, so this is a unique opportunity. Typically, we'll do like a photo shoot together, like we did with Matt Nichols from Bring Me the Horizon, where we all took our shirts off for some reason, and Alan Malik.
My mom has that photo framed.
Yeah. What's the photographer's name? Adam L. Macias? Is that right?
Adam L. Macias,
I think. Adam L. Macias took that photo. Mm-hmm. So he took that picture. You know, we'll do stuff like that, or we'll hang out on the bus and watch a movie or whatever. So this is a question actually that Tim came up with. What is one of the biggest struggles that you've had to overcome as a drummer, and how did you overcome it?
I think it's mainly just like I kind of accidentally became a drummer for my career, I guess. And like, you know, I always really enjoyed doing it. I taught myself kind of by just listening to music and joined some local bands and found myself touring and stuff. So I feel like I've always kind of just doubted my playing. I've always like, I've never had like this really, even to like, I'm confident as a drummer more now than I was, but I mean, I feel like I'm always, since I know that all these areas I've never really technically learned the right way of how to learn a lot of things. I'm always kind of doubting my playing and doubting just a lot of things with my drumming, and you know, just down on myself harder than I should be, like about a lot of things. And I think that that's probably the hardest thing I've had to overcome.
Yeah.
With it.
So how do you work through that mental roadblock? How do you get through a day on tour or a week on tour where you're really thinking about that and you're cognizant about it?
I think it's like when we have a really good show, mm-hmm. like just when I walk off stage and you know, you have that just like, man, I really killed that show. And then on the reverse side of that coin, if I have a show where I don't think I did that well, it's going to ruin my whole entire night, possibly the next day.
The same
you
way.
Know?
Yeah.
But I feel like it's just the energy from the shows and how I comprehend how I played it. I'm just constantly just in my head about over analyzing like every little fill I do or something.
Yeah.
Right.
There's definitely a happy medium where I need to find that. Cause I mean, it's good to want to play better, but I feel like there's like it's kind of an unhealthy amount with me sometimes. I'm certain shows, I feel like I'm just beating myself up way too hard about it.
Sure. Yeah, I mean, I'm the same way. I feel like a lot of drummers are like that too. What is your drum tech's role in encouraging you or in critiquing you? Does he play a part in any of that?
Oh yeah, David is he's just as much a part of this band, I feel like, as any of us when it comes to, at least for me, like he just morale-wise, he's like just knowing he's there and always like no matter what happens, like after the show, he'll talk to me, tell me, you know, what he thought, like he'll always even, he knows if I'm having a bad show and he'll come up to me and, you know, talk me up a little better, like then you know, he can tell when I'm not feeling it.
Sure.
So,
man,
yeah,
that's huge.
He's awesome. He's the man.
That's huge. I don't know that a drum tech or someone that's aspiring to work for a band would calculate that factor. I think that that's something that a lot of crew members.
Yeah, it's a huge part.
It is a huge part. It really is. That's such an important asset to you in the band, and yet, you know, a lot of techs just aren't like that. Their job's to be there, string guitars, get the job done.
Crew members in general, like, yeah, I feel like just the personal connection with the people you're working with and traveling with is such a big part. Like,
yeah.
I feel like it's just as big of a part as how good they are at their job.
Right.
Yeah. On both sides.
Yeah. You know, Matt said a lot of similar things about Spencer when you guys were touring, just about the things that he was able to help you improve and you know, the encouragement he was able to give you, but also the critiques that were able to, you know, drive you to be a better drummer overall. So that's awesome.
It is awesome.
I've never been at the level to have a drum tech.
It's pretty rad.
I've always had to tune my own drum.
It is.
Lug my own gear. My bandmates didn't even help me with my gear.
Well, that, yeah. I mean, naturally.
Yeah.
So,
that's funny.
So this is kind of a cliche question, but if you could go back in time and talk to your younger self, what's something you think you would tell yourself?
That's a good one. Hold on. I gotta think about that, you know? There's a lot I could say.
Yeah, I'm sure. That's a loaded question.
Well, I would just probably tell myself to just, you know, just keep at it. And, you know, like, because it's obviously hard, the, you know, from the beginning to where we all are now, you know, like, just there's been times where I've wanted to quit, you know, like there's been times where, you know, some of our first European tours were just miserable, cold and sick, not getting along, you know, fighting with your, I used to be really terrified of flying for a few years.
Yeah.
Like cripplingly scared of flying. And I almost quit the band because of it. And so I feel like I would just tell myself, like, it's not that big of a deal. It'll work out. You got to go for it. Do it.
Yeah.
Flying's not that scary.
Yeah, for sure. Flying's pretty safe, actually.
Yeah. It was like an irrational fear I had. It just, like, took over. It, like, consumed me for a few years. Yeah. It was bad.
Well, we all have those, right? I just wonder, like, I asked you that question. Now I'm, like, wondering, like, man, if I had to answer that myself, I don't know if advice given to me from my future self would actually help me at all.
You'd be like, yeah, okay, boomer.
Like, yeah, right, exactly.
That's true.
Yeah. That's good, though. I like that.
Yeah, it's, I don't know. My neighbor always tells me this. He's like, there's no such thing as regrets. You made a decision at the time that you made it, and at the time you thought it was a good decision, and now you don't. So it's not so much that you regret it, you've just grown, you've changed.
Yeah.
And I think that's probably a good way to put it.
Yeah.
It's think about how damaging it would be to just constantly live in a sea of regret, thinking about all the mistakes that we've made in our lives and letting that overshadow today, right now. That's a terrible reality for a lot of people.
I feel like it's an easy thing to slip into, though. Sometimes I feel like, depending on what it is, like small or big, like I feel like it's easy to let that, like, affect you without trying. I feel like you have to make an effort not to.
For sure.
No,
constant battle.
Yeah. Yeah, we talk a lot in this podcast just about how mental drumming is, but I mean, realistically, I think it's just because life in general is constantly mental.
Yeah.
It's like, you know, psyching yourself into something or psyching yourself out of something. It's constant.
I mean,
you
have to live with your own thoughts every single second of every day. You can't just, like...
And there's those who can like get a handle on it and move forward, and then there's those that it's just like,
yeah,
you get stuck, you know.
Yeah.
When I first asked you to do this podcast, Alex, you were talking about how you had a lot going on. You said something about how you had your wedding planned, but you were having complications with the venue not honoring their, what was it, like refund or whatever. So talk us through getting married this year and just everything that's happened. Like your friends threw you a wedding, you know.
Mm. Yeah.
So, so we originally were supposed to get married April 19th. And it was like a month before we finally had everything done. We were like about to do it, you know. It was going to be like 100 people or so, like not a huge wedding, but not small. We were all really excited. We had friends and family flying in for it. And then about 2 weeks before, obviously venue is like, no, we can't do it. It was like the beginning of COVID kind of thing. And so we're like, okay, we'll postpone it till, I think it was like July or something like that. And then assuming it would be fine by then we get about a month out. Venue said no. So we're like, okay, well, screw it. We're just going to do like a stream wedding. Like we set up a YouTube, like a private YouTube link, had like a chat and stuff.
Oh,
for,
cool.
For like all the people who were supposed to be there. Like, so they were all like a part of it. We had friends send us like these virtual cheers. Like, so while we're at the reception, it was nice. Like playing on a screen.
Oh,
it was
dude,
really cool.
That's
we got
so
really
awesome.
Drunk really fast though, because it was so many cheers. It was just like, okay, time to drink again. Okay. But it was honestly really cool. Like,
yeah.
COVID or not, I'm kind of glad that's how we did it, because I get really anxious having to like talk or whatever or around like that many people. And so yeah. I was kind of glad it was just I could enjoy every second of that day without having to like be pulled into 1,000 directions from like friends and family at our wedding.
Yeah.
So it's like, because one thing I've heard from number one thing I've heard from people who've got married like on their wedding day was like, just make sure you enjoy every second of it, because it's easy to like just have it go like that. So
yeah,
I was kind of glad that we did that regardless.
Yeah.
It was
yeah.
really cool.
So then your friends, you were saying last night, your friends knocked on the door, you went outside, and what was outside waiting for you?
So the day we were originally supposed to get married, we were just hanging out at the house, and all of a sudden we hear like this, it was like, sound like a cop knocking on the door, just like someone's banging on the door, and we're like, what the fuck's going on? And so we go outside, and there's Neil and a few other of our friends. They start honking and stuff, and there's this little table with like a cake and champagne and stuff. And it was really cool. And they like threw us a little, like, we just hung out in social distance in the front yard and had like a little like improv kind of just celebration thing. It was really cool.
Hmm.
Scared the That's shit awesome. Out of me at first, though.
Yeah.
I didn't know it was happening.
That's such an amazing surprise. Like, that is that's creative.
Because I just hear honking and then like just banging on the door. I'm like, what the fuck is happening? All the neighbors are like outside, like, what is happening right now?
And didn't awesome. They have like a table set up for you, and you and your wife sat
down?
Yeah,
it was like a little table with a cloth. Yeah, it was really cool. I was like, man, you guys are really sweet. You got some good friends.
That's awesome.
Seriously.
Yeah.
Yeah, it was cool.
That is cool.
That's really cool.
When you realize, the older I get, the more introverted I get, and the less I like being around a lot of people. But in terms of an event like that, where you want to celebrate the person that you love, it is so cool to know that there are people in your life who care about you and they want to be close to you. They want to do nice things for you. The opposite of that would be just a life of solidarity, which for a lot of people is COVID. It's this year. It's a year of isolation. It's a year of just like, it's very depressing for a lot of people. And so I have to remind myself, like, it's good to have people in your life who care about you and want to be there for you. And that's the first thing I noticed when I saw that. I think you post like a video or something of just like Neil driving by and, you know, it's like hanging out the car, you know, people are staying in the back of a pickup truck. Like, that's that is a memory you'll always have. And and it's important as a married couple, in my opinion, to have a community around you who was there from the beginning. And if you need stuff, they're there to help you. You know, they're there to stand in and just propel you forward. So
exactly.
That really stuck with me. I thought that was so cool. I know a lot of you, probably a lot of people listening to this have had a tough time with, you know, whether you were going to get married or you had events planned. I thought you guys did a good job of navigating uncertain times and just doing your best, you know.
It was definitely weird, but it ended up being a great memory, and I think in an even cooler way than what we originally planned.
What you originally planned, yeah.
It was definitely confusing. Yeah, I don't know. I loved it. We originally wanted to do something small anyways, but, you know, like, weddings are more for the family and friends anyways, so we're just glad that we just had COVID as an excuse to do it the way we originally wanted it, you know? But
yeah. That's great.
Yeah.
Yeah. This, I say it a lot, especially, like, with my coworkers and stuff, but, like, COVID has forced a lot of people to be, like, innovative. And it's really, like, I think it's really made, like, forced everybody to come out of their shells a little bit and, like, show their true colors, you know, because there's certain people that are, like, thriving during this time, you know, like, being stuck inside, not, you know, seeing anybody. And there's some people that are just loving it. Like, don't change anything. Like, I don't want any, I want to be able to ride this excuse to not see anybody for as long as I can. And then there's other people who are just going nuts, like pulling their hair out and like.
I think I'm a little bit of like all three of those, like just a little sprinkle of this.
I've gotten to know myself a lot more though.
Yeah, like, for sure.
For the first, like the first couple months, it really wasn't that hard for me. And I was like, oh man, so I really don't have much of a life anyway, because like it's not, nothing's really changed. everyone out here complaining, I can't go out, and you know, I'm like, oh, it's, you know, putting my son to bed just like normal. It's, it's like, whatever.
You're like, but, wait, there's a global pandemic going on. What's COVID? I didn't even know.
It's crazy, but it's nice. It's nice hearing that like glass half full mentality that you have, and hearing how there was a positive that actually came out of it, you know, because there's not a lot of positivity going on around, at least not social media.
Not. I mean, it's hard. I definitely like have my days where, you know, I'm definitely not all like happy go lucky, but like, you know, I still try to pull myself out of it as much as I can, because you know, it's hard to once you get too down that path of just being negative, it's kind of hard to pull out of that.
Yeah, near impossible. That's crazy. So I have a out of the box question for you. I was reaching into the deep into the pocket.
Into the 90s with this question.
Into the 90s, yeah. So, okay, so here's the setting. You know, it's 1998, 1999. You know, you're walking or riding your bike around the neighborhood, baggy jeans and all. what CDs were you playing on repeat on your Discman? 90s.
Offspring.
Okay.
Offspring, I think it was Americana. Chumbawamba, Tub Thumper.
Yep.
My edited Limp Bizkit CD from Walmart, because all of Walmart CDs were edited.
Yeah.
Significant Other or Insignificant Other. Lit, A Place in the Sun.
Yes. Nice.
Since it's 98, Enema of the State wasn't out yet, so it wasn't
that. Yeah. I was thinking about that. I was like, I bet there's a Blink-182 reference coming
you
here.
You could go 99 if you want. It's okay.
Yeah.
And Listen, Jake, Losing Streak.
Ooh, yes.
Man, good.
So you were a ska guy for a little bit there, huh?
Yeah.
Yeah. It's okay.
I was like super into like Anti-Flag, NoFX, Listen, Jake, like.
Yeah, I wasn't as big into punk as Alex was. But when you said Limp Bizkit, I thought about something. So were you on those festivals where Limp Bizkit was headlining? Did you do any of those?
They're incredible live. Yeah.
They're incredible live. So
yeah, so good.
Did you guys play, from what I remember, you guys played pretty near the top of the bill, close to them. Is that correct?
A couple bands from, yeah.
Okay, yeah. So
like a couple bands before.
Yeah, so talk to me about your experience when you show up to a big festival in Europe like that, for those that will never experience what it's like to be a part of a festival with 100 bands and some of your heroes as a kid, like Limp Bizkit, is playing three or four bands after you. What's it like walking on that stage and like you walk by Limp Bizkit's kit, you know, and then you see System of a Down's kit, you see Korn's kit. I have these just amazing memories of seeing all these drum sets lined up, and the front kick drum head is like, you know, Tommy Lee. And what what's it like when you're walking to your set and you're walking by all these, you know, legendary bands, you know, backline? Is it something that you've gotten used
anxiety.
To, or is it? Yeah. Okay. Anxiety.
Anxiety. Like yeah. not, I literally like those, some of those festivals, like those set, like I'm just pacing. I'm just like, you know, and yeah. the stage is so big too, like to where like the crowd starts like 100 feet away from you. So like, I feel like, and yeah. then you're also on a riser and it feels like, you know, not every single person staring at you, but I feel like since you're so far
right.
away from everything, it feels like everyone's just staring at you and you're like, that's a lot of fucking people just yeah. staring at you.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
So it's just, it's a wild feeling. Like the sets, like when we're playing, even if it's like an hour set, it seems like it's like 10 minutes or something.
I know.
Like, cause it just goes by like this. Like it's nuts.
And you're on a big TV screen. Huge, just like
yeah.
huge Jumbotron TV screens. I got so nervous at one of those festivals. I think it was called Summer Breeze. Did you play there? Summer Breeze Festival?
I don't think so.
Okay. There were probably 20,000 people there. And I was so nervous that I didn't go out front before we played because I didn't want to see how big the TV screens were. Like, I didn't want to know what it was like.
I'm the same way.
It's like, well, please, yeah. They're going to be zooming way. In. There's a
it's
drum
such a
cam
crazy,
and,
yeah.
Ah, man.
Oh, yeah. It's wild.
It's incredible, the production
so
they put
crazy.
Into those. But
yeah.
I think,
yeah.
Then they have like multiple PAs, like not just the PA at the stage. They have the ones that are like at front of house.
Yeah.
Then they have ones that are like even for, it's crazy.
Yeah, all
yeah,
the
like
delay.
On a delay. Yep. Yep.
Yeah, and the thing that I didn't think about till you said it is the drum riser. Typically, we have these drum risers that put you up so tall. And like you said, the stage is huge. So you're sitting here in the middle of an empty stage, and you're so far away from the first person, you can hardly even see
and
them.
And it just feels like...
So it just feels like you're...
feels like every single person. It's nuts.
Yeah.
It's
yeah,
so
it feels
crazy.
Like you're playing a drum solo.
I honestly hate tall drum risers. I always fight with, like... If we have a tour production where the drum riser is going to be like 4 feet tall, I'm like, please no. Like, I would like if I could, I would set up on the floor of the stage.
Yeah, yeah.
Like, I don't know what it is. It's a weird mental thing. I hate tall drum risers.
Yeah, it's like the good old days,
it's,
man.
It's
back
crazy.
When we used to play on the floor of the Legion Hall or the skate park and just play the show.
Yeah.
Don't think about production. No one sees
you.
You're
don't even,
hiding
yeah, you
behind
don't think
your set.
Of, exactly.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's great.
It is great.
Like the,
I actually agree with you.
It's like the most, or it's like the least rock star thing I've probably ever said. like, give me a, I don't want a drum riser. Just put me under the stage.
Yeah, no, but it's interesting that you're bringing that up. I mean, both of you guys are obviously at a higher level than I've ever been, but like, I was even thinking about this like back in the day because, like, our rehearsal space was relatively small, and we could all clearly see each other, make eye contact throughout practicing through the set. And then most of the places we played were relatively small. But then, like, occasionally, if there was a performing arts center or some kind of big level, you know, higher level venue, it was like it threw off our game.
Yeah.
Because it's like we couldn't hear each other the same way. We couldn't communicate on stage the same way. And I guess, like, if you're like Linkin Park or somebody like touring on these like major, huge stages and festivals all, you know, all across the world, you get used to it after a while. But like, man, it's going from one setting to another setting is just, you know, it can completely disrupt your flow.
Oh, 100%.
It's way different.
100%. Yeah, and then, like, different. We've all played those venues where the sound is so tight that you can hear every nuance and every mistake. Mm-hmm. When you put in your in-ears and you do sound check, you know immediately. You're like, oh, geez, this is one of those venues. One in particular is in New York City. It used to be called PlayStation or Nokia or Best Buy.
Oh, the Best Buy Theater. Best Buy Theater. Yeah. Yep.
That place has tight sound. Like, it's just,
it sounds incredible.
It's
perfect
sound. Yeah. You cannot make mistakes there. Everyone knows it.
No.
Otherwise, if you play it like the Palladium in Worcester, Massachusetts, it's like a huge theater that reverberates, and it's like, oh, this is child's play.
Yeah.
This is easy. You can make ton of mistakes. It still sounds awesome.
Exactly.
You
know?
So, it's wild.
So
it's
funny. Our final question here that Tim and I have is, speak to the drummers who tune into this podcast. So there are inevitably going to be those who love Data Remember. They love your drumming. There's a lot to be said about your drumming, Alex. And without grandstanding, I'll grandstand for 5 seconds and then I'll be done. But your feet have always been very tight, and I think you would agree with that. Your feet are locked in. You can tell it's never been a struggle for you. You lock in with those threes. You lock in with that double bass pattern. Like, every time, it just sounds awesome. I remember seeing you warm up at Warped Tour 2008 when we shared a stage with Katy Perry, that split stage that we were doing. And, your feet have just always been tight. So, speak to the drummers who are listening to this podcast, and maybe they're trying to learn something that can benefit their own playing or their own, you know, future as a drummer, playing in a band, trying to be as proficient as they can be. What would you say to them?
I think I can only speak to kind of how I taught myself, I guess. I feel like one of the best things that's helped me, whether it's for my feet or hands or timing or whatever, is just honestly like playing like whatever music, whatever genre or band you're trying to start, like listen to some of your favorite bands like that and just play them over and over with the song. And I feel like we're playing with a click too. Like, that helps a lot. I remember I listened to a lot of that Bury Your Dead Cover Your Tracks record when I was learning. So, I mean, a lot of my feet stuff is from Mark. Like, a lot of the stuff he wrote was, like, some of the coolest, like, the little, like, that kind of stuff. And I feel like just doing that subconsciously made me better at just, like, being on time.
Yeah.
Like, not, you know, just, like, and just doing, I would do that for, like, 3-4 hours a day when I was starting, you know. Just like listening to, whether it was punk music, whether it was like heavy music, whether it was, you know, whatever. And just kind of, and it kind of gave me it kind of subconsciously made me realize why there's certain fills for here. And it kind of like made me realize like, oh, the drums should follow the guitar here, or like the kick pattern with the vocal pattern here. It kind of like, you kind of can hear why something does something. Like, it's not just a you know, it's not random, you know. I feel like that kind of is a big, just kind of subconsciously learn reasons of why you're doing something instead of just doing it to do it kind of thing.
That's awesome.
If that makes any sense.
That's really good.
Yeah, I mean, I think there's a lot of truth to playing along with music that you like listening to and doing it for a long time.
Yeah.
That Bury Your Dead record has sick, like, burst patterns. You know, and if you can get that stuff down, your feet are going to be just... It makes sense to me. I didn't know that about you, but it makes sense now why your double bass is what it is, because I hear some of that quick burst stuff.
I played that record so much.
Yeah.
So like that.
I want to go listen to that now.
Feet to that. Oh yeah.
Yeah.
The whole record is sick.
Mark, man, he was an idol for me too. Back on the Between the Bird and Me Silent Circus record.
Yeah. He's insane.
Oh, insane drummer.
I actually, the first time I saw them was actually the first time I saw you guys in Ocala.
Oh, yeah?
With,
it was Terror.
Bury Your Dead, you guys, Terror.
Scars of Tomorrow. Wow.
Yeah.
Really? I did not know that. Man.
Yeah, that was like a couple months before I joined A Day to Remember.
Oh, wow.
Huh.
That's awesome.
Yeah, I didn't know that. That's a tour.
In that like big gym in Ocala.
Oh, jeez. Awesome. That was so, that was so loud in there. Oh, my gosh.
Yeah. That show was violent. I remember.
Every show was pretty violent.
It was like actually kind of terrifying.
Bury Your Dead Terror. There were crews were coming out and...
Jeez.
Death Before Dishonor played too, I think, or something.
Oh man, that brings back so many memories. You know, that was 15 years ago.
Yeah,
crazy.
15 years ago.
It's crazy.
So actually, let's talk about that for a second. This wasn't planned, but so one day you're going to a show, watching one of your favorite bands, Bury Your Dead, seeing Matt's band play, and then a little while later, you're playing for A Day to Remember, goes on to be one of the biggest, you know, metal, pop punk. I don't what genre do you guys classify yourselves as? Is it punk?
I have no
metal?
Idea. I have no idea.
Either way, one of the biggest bills on a Warped Tour, or you know, you guys are headlining shows like crazy. What was that like? Like, what was the experience joining the band? You know, you obviously, your drumming has influenced the sound of the band immensely.
Mm-hmm.
So it's not even like you just joined some band that was already famous, you know,
you helped build it.
We're there from the beginning, helped shape who they are. What's that like? What was that experience like?
Oh man, it was wild. I was 15. I randomly got asked by Josh and Neil, because their drummer was on probation, if I could go on tour in 2 days. And then...
Wow.
My mom said yeah, and ended up going on tour. And then, it was wild. It's the craziest, like, weirdest right place, right time, right... Just everything kind of... It was strange. It was like, if one little thing was a little bit different... Like, I wouldn't be doing this. Yeah, it's weird.
Yeah. 15 years old.
It's definitely something I always think. It's always something I think about. Yeah, it's very...
Wow.
It's very strange. A lot of things that just kind of worked out perfectly.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. Man.
Wow. That's really cool.
I have no idea about
that. I'm really glad that you are the drummer for the band. You know, we're sort of looking at this from like a what if scenario, like what if you weren't there and what if you weren't friends with Josh and Neil, what if they didn't ask you? But I'm really glad it was you, because and if you're listening to this, this might be something to think about if you're starting a band and you're looking for other band members. You need somebody that is going to be teachable and is able to work with other people and doesn't always need to be at the front of the stage, the loudest part of the conversation. And Alex, that's you. You've always been foundational for the band. You've done your job well, but you haven't been someone who takes up all the space. And as you can, I mean, we've talked about this before too, but like, I can't imagine being in a band where there are a couple people that are just, impossible to be around. It just wouldn't work.
Yeah.
And so I'm glad for A Day to Remember's sake that you're the drummer, and I'm glad for your sake that you have A Day to Remember because, well
yeah. Thank you.
For a lot too. Of reasons, but you're on this podcast and we're friends because you're in a band. So I wouldn't know you otherwise. we would have never met, very presumably.
No. That's funny. That's pretty crazy.
That's crazy.
And it's true. I mean, you really make, I've been impressed. I've seen you guys two or three times, and every time I've seen you, I've been so impressed with how tight you guys play. And, you know, I'm a pop punk fan. I listen to metal, but I'm not a metal drummer. So I always appreciated that about you guys, that you kind of had both sides. Mm-hmm. And it says a lot about you as a metal drummer that, you know, you can show off when you need to show off and play some really, you know, complicated, insane parts, but also lock it down. And I mean, when I listen to your music, there's a lot of pocket stuff in there. You know, there's a lot of you're just sitting back playing a groove, and that's not typical of metal. Uh-huh. It's a little bit more typical of pop punk, but like it's even pop punk. I mean, Travis Barker never just sits back and wild. You know, occasionally, but you know, it's always insane. But you have the ability to kind of pull back and just give a song what it needs. And I think that's, you know, there's a lot to say about
that.
So something when you do podcasts, you're told not to grandstand, right? Like, don't talk about the guest in a way that you're going to flatter them and you're going to elevate them. But the thing is, with our guest, Tim, I like our guests. Otherwise, we wouldn't have invited them. Like, right. I want them to be here because
just
I like...
Just talk shit to me, Matt.
Yeah.
Just talk shit
them,
to me.
I like them as people. So we're grandstanding you, yes. We fully acknowledge that. Therefore, it's okay. If you're if you're ignorant to the fact that you're grandstanding, then okay, it gets annoying. But the bottom line is we like our guests and we like the art that they make. And we've had Spears on here, we've had Cobus on here, we've had Luke Collin on here, and we have a lot of respect for all these guys. They're all very different from one another. Mm-hmm. And I think that that's sort of the beauty of drumming, is that you have this, I'm sitting at my kit, but we have one instrument with a limited amount of sounds, and yet we've talked to maybe, I don't know, 10 guests, Tim, and they all have done something significantly different with that same instrument. I just think that's so cool. I think that is just very impressive.
Oh yeah. Drumming's wild.
Yeah.
There's so many different styles and ways you can hit the same thing in a million different ways. It's cool.
Yeah.
Oh, that's funny.
And especially like they're still coming out with like new ways to play drums. It's insane. Like I would think like after you see a Benny Greb or like Johnny Rab or something like that, you're like, oh well, it's all been done at this point. Like you know, what other pieces of a drum could you hit? You know, they've used everything. But I'm still seeing new stuff every day on Instagram. Like there's still new grooves coming out, new, you know, ways to play a kit. It's it's awesome. It's insane. Everyone's got their own thing.
What's your reaction, Alex, to scrolling Instagram? You know, this year you're not playing as much, you're sort of not very motivated to play. What is your reaction to scrolling Instagram and seeing drumming videos, drumming pictures, drumming this, drumming that? What does that do to you as you're scrolling? You scroll
makes
right
me
past it?
Wish I was doing.
You unfollow?
No, I still watch a lot of drum stuff. I still get stoked on watching all that stuff. But again, it kind of just makes me be like, man, I need to start doing this again or more, you know. It's always in my head.
Yeah. It's a weird thing, the fact that we have access to all this content and you see what everybody else is doing with their day, you know, all that person's practicing or all that person's playing this song or whatever. And I think a lot of times for me it can be very negative. It can have negative consequences. Yeah. And then other days, to your point, like it's cool. Like you're like, oh, sweet, this is awesome. But oftentimes I'll just go scrolling right past drum stuff and get to, you know, farming stuff or whatever it is that I'm actually interested in that day. Sports. Sports Center is a good follow.
There you go.
But, you know, there's other days where it's like, oh, this is awesome. I want to watch this drummer. play. But it, yeah. I have found it's tougher for me to enjoy that kind of content if I'm not also doing it. If I'm plugged in and I'm practicing a lot, then I'm then I'm pumped.
Yeah.
That's awesome. So I guess before we wrap up, we have a Patreon with a number of people who support us on a monthly basis, and we call them our inner circle, and we give them the opportunity to submit questions for our guests. So if you have a couple minutes, we have a few that I'll throw out there for you. So our first one is from Nick Abbott. And he has a question, but he wanted to let you know, his first date with his wife was actually at the house party tour.
Sick.
So he's a big fan of
loved
you guys.
It, love to hear it.
And,
that's awesome.
Yeah. I love to hear it.
That's cool.
So you had a hand in someone's marriage. That's pretty cool.
That's awesome.
Or a couple hands, technically, because you were probably.
nice.
Yeah, that was bad. That was a bad one. Sorry. So Nick asks, what would you say your biggest weakness in drumming is?
My rudiments. I'm really bad. Rudiments and stuff. I'm just really. Yeah, you hand me a marching snare or something, I'll hand it right back.
Yeah.
I'm like, no, thanks. Yeah. <You know? laughs>
Take this back.
I'm the same.
I don't want this. Yep. Yeah. I don't know what this is.
Yeah. That's funny.
Where's the rest?
Yeah.
Where's the rest of the kit? Yeah. What is this? You want me to make pasta in this pot?
Yeah, like, exactly.
Where's the rest is amazing.
Where's the rest of it?
That's the name of this episode.
Where's the rest?
Alex Shelnutt, where's the rest?
Alex Shelnutt. That's fun. Our next question, actually, I have a couple questions from Jeffrey Lash. And he wanted to know, first off, what made you get into drumming?
Honestly, I took lessons with guitar for a year and a half or two, and I wanted to join a band, but everyone played guitar. No one played drums, and I knew how to play drums enough because my dad had a drum kit that I would kind of just fart around on every now and then, and so ended up just became a drummer.
That's awesome. That's great.
Fart around
on
reason like
as
that.
Anyone else, right?
Yeah,
that's awesome. And then he also had another question. So he's a Florida guy as well, and he wanted to know if you ever go to the Record Store Foundation in College Park.
Oh yeah, I'm actually friends with a couple of the dudes there. They're rad. They we have a bunch of mutual friends that I just kind of stumbled in there and. They have some really cool stuff. They have a lot of cool, old vintage clothing, records, a bunch of just random nice. Stuff. It's a cool place.
Mm. Nice.
Sweet. And then our last question is from Drake Crowley. And he's also a Florida guy. And he just wants to know how he can get a jam session set up with you.
Oh, jeez. Bold request.
Fix COVID. And
yeah,
we'll talk.
Fix COVID. There you go. Bold answer.
Bold request. Where it's a bold answer. You got it.
Yeah,
that's amazing.
There you go, Drake.
If you do that, let's go.
A lot of us will be thanking you if you can do that.
Yeah,
yep. Yeah.
For sure.
If you can do that, wow, you'll get more than a jam session with Alex.
Yeah, for sure.
That's funny.
Oh man. This was fun.
Well, dude,
this was so fun.
Yeah, thank you so much for coming on, man. It was
thanks for having me.
It was a blast.
I'm glad I ended up doing it. I wasn't in a great headspace last time Matt asked me, so I was like, I don't want to just do it. I want to I want to be as excited.
Yeah, absolutely.
As I can be.
Yeah, I'm glad that you wanted to do it badly enough that you weren't just willing to compromise on it. And typically when we do a podcast and we have technical issues, which we've had this entire episode, It means
I'm recording my audio at least.
It's going to be popular. So, yeah, it's on all of our ends. Like, if you're still listening to this,
every single one of us has.
We've all had issues. Yeah. If you're listening to this, just know that Tim lost content. Question content.
I lost all my questions right before we
started. I lost my Pro Tools file, and Alex is
and
using dial-up internet.
I'm hotspotting my phone.
So. But you know what? That's, like I said, our best episodes always come out this way. So
that's right. And people will definitely get a lot out of this one. It was a good one. And yeah, man, thanks so much for coming on and powering through. And
yeah,
it was really great to hear everything you had to say.
Absolutely.
Well, I appreciate it. It was fun. Very fun.
Absolutely. Yeah. Okay. Well, thank you so much. And if people want to follow along with you on social media or with the Data Remember, where should they go to do that?
My Twitter and Instagram are just both Alex Shelnutt, 1L2Ts. It's a little confusing, I know, but yeah, and I don't have Facebook, so just Instagram and Twitter. Wait. Okay, I'm still recording. Cool.
Nice.
Thought something went wrong.
Nice. Good stuff.
Good stuff.
All right. Well, follow Alex and check out his band if you haven't. I like a lot of a Data Remembers stuff from old to new. And if you haven't heard it, you're missing out. So check it out.
Yeah, for sure.
Thank you, Alex. We'll talk soon.
Thanks, y'all.
I think we lost him. A fitting end to. Oh, there you are. There you are.
Fitty dead. Yep, exactly. I remember when I first saw the country. I remember sleeping in the van. Say goodbye to friends and family. Cause they could never understand. I remember jumping off the cliff tops. I remember playing with no one there. Yeah, I know if I became successful, it would change who I am. Swear I'm. Okay, so hope you guys enjoyed that episode with Alex. As you can tell, he's just the kind of person that you would want to hang out with and be friends with. And he's really someone that we can all look up to in a lot of ways. He's a role model because he doesn't consider himself one. Mm-hmm. And I know he wouldn't say that about himself, but I can. And Tim and I can both agree on that. We've talked about it off air quite a bit. He really gets behind things that he believes in, even if it's our Rinky Dink podcast. Mm-hmm. Texting me saying, hey, when's this coming out? I'm really excited about it. And, you know, just getting behind things that he believes in. So if you liked what you heard and you haven't seen any of his drumming, go check him out.
Yeah.
If you haven't heard any Data Remember, go check them out. They're fantastic. Yeah. They're one of my favorite bands to see live. Mm-hmm. I don't listen to a lot of music and I don't go to shows often, but when they were headlining Warped Tour, you know, I would try to go see him as often as I could. Self-Help Festival. Mm-hmm. Touring with them 10 years ago. They're just a band that they're just so fun. They do everything so well. And without Alex in the band, it certainly wouldn't be the same band. And I'm really glad that they have him and that he has them because, well, it's just a good equation. You know, you put the two together. So
really
thank
is.
You, Alex, for doing it.
Yeah,
and
thanks, man.
Thank you so much for listening to this. It was a good conversation that I think benefited myself and Tim and hopefully all of you too.
Yeah agree 100%. Yeah, the first time I saw them was actually at the Electric Factory in Philly.
Oh, nice.
I met up with you, so I was there to meet up with you. You guys played and then I think they headlined, so I watched their shows. The first time I'd seen them and I was just like so blown away. I mean, their album's tight, you know. But I know what goes into making a record, and there's a lot of post-production. There's a lot of sweetening that goes on. And so you never know, like, is this band going to sound...
Can they pull it off?
Yeah, can they actually sound like their album? And I actually felt like, at least Alex, and I watch drummers, so, you know, of course I'm going to perceive this, but I felt like Alex played better live than on the album. I was
His
very
feet are
impressed.
So tight.
Dude,
it
was so
I mean, we talked about that on
tight.
The podcast, but he is precise.
Yeah.
And I mean, we're talking about him now, but I can picture him playing. He has a certain way of playing. Yeah. He's just a very special part of the drumming community.
Yeah.
Who I would argue is underrated and under-talked about. And I hope this podcast gives him some notoriety that maybe he didn't have before. And if not, then okay. Yeah. No problem, but at least we got to have him on here.
At least we had a good time.
At least we got to hang out with him.
So go follow him if you're not already. Alex Shelnutt, 1L, 2Ts. Yeah, good. You're going to get some good stuff from him. So
you bet.
Definitely do that. So wrapping up, I'm going to give a few shout-outs to some new Patreon supporters. If you missed the beginning of the episode, we do have a Patreon. It's patreon.com/holyghostnotes. Just a cool way for us to connect with you guys and for you to get a little bit more involved in this podcast and for us to give you some cool stuff. So we have a community group called The Inner Circle, and I'm just going to give some shout-outs to some new members. So shout-out to Aaron Johnson, Marcel Chamberlain, and Zach Cleave.
Nice.
Fellas, welcome to the Inner Circle.
Thank
Good
you guys so
you.
Much for signing up. It's great to have you.
Thank
we
you
wouldn't be able to do this without you guys. We've been doing this a long time now, and we would have been able to do it without anybody in the beginning because we did. But as is the case with any hobby, passion, eventually, hopefully, business model, you have to have support. And thank you guys. Yeah. It means a lot. We're happy to have you on board. It is truly a community, and
truly
we love
a delight.
You all very much. It's also truly a delight. And what a rush.
What a rush. Classic. An instant classic.
Thank you very much for listening. And,
thank you guys for listening.
We'll be seeing you.
Yeah, yeah. And make sure you're using the hashtag HolyGhostNotes on your drum videos because we do a Groove of the Week every week. And if you have any questions or comments or concerns, hit us up, Matt and Tim at theholyghostnotes.com, or you can hit us up on Instagram or Facebook. And did you know that we have a Twitter? Apparently, I set up a Twitter for us back in February of 19.
I did not. Oh,
and
nice.
I just rediscovered it. So, hey, go follow us on Twitter if you're not already. I'm going to try to post some different content up on there. So that's twitter.com/holyghostnotes.
So much content.
So much content all the time. Goodness gracious. But, yeah, thank you guys for listening. You're the best. We love you all. And we'll see you again soon.
So. You bet. You know what time it is. 3, 2, 1. Peace! Yeah!